Hi, my name is Pablo Gomez, and I'm an exchange student at UC San Diego and a member of the BioClock Studio for the winter 2016 quarter, and I'm here to interview Dr. Ev Van Cauter. What motivated you to pursue a career in science and become a researcher?
Well, I always enjoy mathematics. I enjoyed puzzles. I'm most comfortable with data, with facts, with clear questions and finding an answer. So kind of mathematical detective work. And so it was natural for me to turn towards the sciences rather than the humanities.
And why sleep in particular?
Well, initially I was interested in the patterns of secretion of hormones. And very, very soon at the beginning of my career, we were able to, because of technological advances, to measure hormonal levels in blood across the 24-hour cycle. And at that time, it was recognized by a number of groups that the sleep period is really important because some hormones are released almost only during sleep, and others are inhibited during sleep. So it became very important to understand sleep and what are the different components of sleep and how sleep can influence hormonal release.
Your lab has found out that sleep deprivation affects the body's metabolism in addition to generating deficits in brain functions, such as memory and alertness. Can you explain what happens to hormones that regulate metabolism after sleep deprivation?
After working first on studies of acute total sleep deprivation, we focused on what we call studies of the sleep debt, which is really what people experience in real life during the week, and then often they try to recover during the weekend. So what our laboratory showed was that glucose tolerance, the ability to metabolize glucose, is impaired in condition of sleep deprivation after a sleep debt. And that one of the major drivers of that is that people become insulin resistant, meaning they need more insulin to metabolize the same amount of glucose. And at that point, when that happens, a normal reaction of the human body is to produce more insulin in order to force the tissue to metabolize the glucose. And what we found is that the pancreas, which is the organ that releases releases insulin, was not able to compensate. So the pancreas did not produce more insulin, but the body needed more insulin, and therefore the glucose level started to rise. And that is why we qualify that state as a state of pre-diabetes that we observed after only 1 week of sleep restriction.
And how is it that these type of experiments are set up?
So we use, we have a facility at the University of Chicago to do these types of studies. We have bedrooms that are residential, you know, like a hotel room, not so much a hospital room, so that the participants don't feel that they are in a medical environment because they have to stay in the laboratory continuously for, you know, most studies are 10 days to 2 weeks. They can go from one room to the other. They have a private bathroom. They have a big television, many movies and games to play. And we tell them ahead of time that it will be boring and that they need to bring a lot of things to entertain themselves. They can have visitors. To sleep-deprived people, we simply tell them that they cannot go to bed until a certain time. They are continuously supervised. If they begin to feel tired, there's a research assistant that will come and watch a game, play a game with them, or you know, entertain them one way or another. The rooms are all equipped to do polysomnography, so every night the sleep is recorded. And when we sample blood, during the night we can have the IV catheter connected to plastic tubing that goes through a hole in the wall to the next room, so that when they sleep, we can sample the blood from the next room without each time entering the room, going in and out. Importantly, while they're in the laboratory, their caloric intake, their meals, are calculated to meet their daily energy requirements, and we make sure that they eat their meals on time and entirely. There's no snacks, and there's no caloric drinks in between the meals.
You're also studying how circadian rhythms affect human metabolism. Can you share some of your findings?
Yes, we were of course interested in how circadian abnormalities, circadian disturbances that are so common in modern society might increase the risk of diabetes. And there is epidemiologic data that suggests, that indicates that people who are shift workers are more likely to develop type 2 diabetes. And as they are shift worker for more years, this risk increases. But the mechanisms are not really fully understood. One mechanism possible is that shift workers always have a sleep debt, because typically, biologically, it's more difficult to have adequate sleep duration when you sleep out of phase with your biological clock. So that's a biologic reason. But there are also social reasons. Environmental reason is that it's more difficult to sleep during the daytime. It's more difficult to block the lights, more difficult to block the noise. And also shift workers want to have normal social interactions during the daytime as well. So typically, they are amongst the most sleep-deprived people of the population, and we were interested to figure out whether both the sleep loss, but also independently of the sleep loss, the circadian misalignment was playing a role in this increased risk of diabetes. And so we designed a laboratory study that essentially mimics, in one group, sleep loss without any circadian misalignment, and the other group is mimicking a shift work schedule. So circadian misalignment literally in our study doubled the effect size of sleep loss on insulin sensitivity. So the change in insulin sensitivity just with sleep loss without circadian misalignment was about 30%. So a 30% decrease of insulin sensitivity is large. It would correspond, for example, to one of us gaining 10 kilo. Then our insulin sensitivity would decrease by 30%. When people were not only sleep deprived, but had a shift work schedule in the laboratory, then their insulin sensitivity decreased by almost 60%. So the circadian misalignment exacerbated the impact of sleep loss on insulin sensitivity.
It is constantly recommended that we sleep at least 7 to 8 hours, and research like the one you do give us compelling reasons to do so. But still many persons, myself included, don't do it because of work or study, or just because we want more time for leisure. So what could we do to change this behavior?
Well, you know, public education will be needed to make people understand that a good diet and exercise have to be associated with sufficient amounts of sleep to really create a healthy life. That will take time. We know that people are not compliant with exercise, and they don't necessarily eat well either. But those who are concerned about their health, I hope, will progressively incorporate sleep hygiene in their lifestyles.
Do you think the sleep science is being accurately communicated?
There are certainly misconceptions around sleep, one of which is the concept that sleep is mostly for brain function and does not affect peripheral physiology, that sleep is to have best cognitive function, attention, reaction times, memory, and so on, but not that sleep is important to remain healthy physically. And that's a misconception that is beginning to decrease because there is so much data to indicate that sleep is not only for the brain, but also for the rest of the body.
What advice would you give a student who wishes to pursue a career in science as a researcher or a medical researcher?
I think the most important is to keep an open mind and jump on another opportunity. So if, you know, like today you may have heard something that may be relevant to the work that you are doing in your laboratory, and to see if you're interested in that, to explore the possibility of taking an additional avenue. I think to always see where the novelty lies and where it might synergize with the approach that you already have, I think is an important way to move forward. You can't stay in the same track. You have to always see ahead. If you remain where you are already behind.